Hello, this is Brian Roberts, and I'm the director of this particular episode of the VeggieTales. And I have some special guests with me today. Say hello, Mr. Mike.
You just said the VeggieTales.
Yes, I did.
That's like the internets.
Exactly. I thought it was funny.
Yes, and I'm one of the cucumbers. as well as one of the writers on the show, this particular show, Robin Good.
And over here I got Mr. Chris Wall.
Greetings!
And Chris is the producer of this particular episode of the VeggieTales.
Nice to be back.
Hey there.
Stepped away a little bit after St. Nicholas.
That's right.
Happy to be back around with the veggies. The veggies.
The VeggieTales.
As I like to call them.
Yes. Mike, you're the only cucumber here, man.
Yeah, Bob, Stephen, Mark,
no,
the
that's
cucumber.
Not true. I'm one of the brothers. I don't know which one. I'm either Bob,
Steve, or Mark, which coincidentally are my actual brothers' names.
Yeah. Because remember, they didn't talk, but they sang, and I was one of them.
Yeah. You did a great job singing.
But that's from a different episode of this
fine
show.
Yeah, so let's talk about this episode.
Talk about this one.
Well, maybe we should start with talking about how this came to be in terms of, you know, why we decided to do this particular story. It actually came from our fans. We sent out a Facebook questionnaire, I believe it was done on Facebook, and we asked,
"Hi kids,
what kind of show would you like VeggieTales to do?" And the overwhelming response was, "Where's God when I'm hurting?
How do we deal with hurt?
How do we deal with
what are God's promises for me when I feel hurt?
Yeah,
or when bad things are happening to me."
Yeah, and we kind of approached that before with little Joe, the story of Joseph. We just wanted to do that again in a way that, you know, just with a couple of really fun stories.
And, but also in a way that was meaningful,
right?
And really spoke to, you know, because we all hurt in different ways, and some in small and some in big. And if you say, hey, here's a show that's to help you when you're hurting, you know, I really felt the burden of making sure that it really had something to say. We all wanted it to say something, but, you know, we wanted to make sure that it really had something to say to people who, you know, no matter what the hurt is, whether it's huge or tiny, that it had a meaningful, you know, biblical message for those people.
Which would be, I think the biblical, that's the thing that was really hard here, was just that there's so many different ways to hurt, from dear Larry losing his hamster to a kid moving, to there's so many different ways for people to hurt.
Right.
And that became the biggest challenge in figuring out what to say.
Right, and, you know, when we were doing a Bible story like Joseph, you can look at the overall and say, wow, look at, you know, how God worked all things for the good in this situation. What some intended for harm, God used for the good. And you can do that when you're doing a Bible story, but when you're telling other stories, you just have to be really careful with how you handle that. And so, you know, this first story, Lenny, you know, we just dealt with, you know, how a child might be hurting when he feels like, you know, people don't care about him, or, you know, on the special occasion of having
they've forgotten about his sweet little birthday.
Now, I love the pop-up book. Talk about your design, Brian, because this was just such a clever way to get it this short time.
Well, it really was motivated out of wanting a style that would present itself simply. At the very beginning, I think we had talked about it being kind of like stage flats, but decided that, well, it's not really a theatrical presentation, so what if it's more of a storybook kind of pop-up presentation? We knew that we were going to have some really complex sets in the Robin Good segment, but this Lenny segment, even though it's fairly short, has lots of different locations that we needed to create. So we wanted to keep them as simple as they could be and kind of use this storybook construct, these little two or three wall sets, where basically everything on the walls is painted, and then the physical props are all very simple, as if they're kind of made out of cardboard.
Now we placed it in South Florida because it is March 1st and it's sunny outside.
Exactly. We didn't want to. We didn't want to put it in like Minnesota, where we would have to have, you know, Lenny trudging through the snow on his birthday.
Now this is where the flats for me comically start to fall down. Mom is staring at a wall.
Right. It looks like she's standing at the stove, but she's actually just standing in front of a flat wall.
She's a great actress.
It could have been
It
could have been the sink, but we couldn't afford plumbing.
Right.
There's the sink under the window.
But she's a follow-through actress. She just pushes through here.
You know, it's kind of like doing Our Town.
And, you know, originally when I wrote this, the first version of this, Dad was in an Air Force uniform. Because when I thought I thought South Florida, I thought Cocoa Beach and I Dream of Jeannie.
Uh-huh. I want to talk about Libby here because this is kind of an exciting thing. This is our first little girl asparagus we've ever had. In this role, she's playing the part of Junior's sister. Within the veggie mythology, I don't know that she'll continue to be Junior's sister. We're not saying Junior has a sister now.
Yes.
But there is a new little girl asparagus who is voiced by Megan Murphy, who actually does the voice of Madame Blueberry and a few of our other
and it looks really cute
characters.
To tie asparagus prongs back in
into ponytails. Yeah, when we first had to create it, I'm like, I don't know how we're going to do an asparagus girl and make that cute.
Yeah.
Mark. Oh, help me. Mark at Hoo Hoo. He sketched up some possibilities, and we quickly zeroed in on that. And we actually created her with a future in mind, because she's also going to show up in the next show, currently titled A Little Princess, although it may have a new title by the time you hear this.
Although, I think a show named Created with a Future in Mind, you know, might be a good title.
Those were some fine, I just want to note, some fine seatbelts in that van.
Yeah.
Those kids were very safe.
Mm-hmm. I had made the directorial decision that they didn't need seatbelts, and then the executive producer made the executive producer decision that they did.
Producer was happy to bring to attention.
Yeah, you gotta have seatbelts.
Which, of course, kids that age now would actually need to be in boosters, so even with the seatbelts, we're still not street legal.
Now, is that the first time we've pulled out the dog since St. Nicholas?
No. He was in 'Twas the Night Before Easter.
Yeah, he was laying in the road eating a donut, actually.
On top of
eating a donut.
Deep snow.
That's right.
There's a little cameo from Gordon.
Yeah, name that show. Later in
line, Minnesota Cuke and the Search for Samson's Hairbrush originally.
Yep.
Like his favorite dessert.
He's very scary as a bully in that one, and here he is back to bullying.
I was just
at
a
not bullying. He's being careless. It was not. You can see there was no intentionality in that movie.
Feel like it was
okay, I was. This is a little side note here, but that's a Jell-O mold in the shape of a Bundt cake. But I was actually. We were at a cake walk at my son's school the other day, and he won the cake walk. You know, it's a fundraiser thing, so he got to choose a cake, and he chose the one that looked like a giant donut. You know, which he had never heard the term Bundt cake before.
Bundt
cake. So he's a giant donut, and I thought, you're right. That is a giant donut. That it's more much more
I love
tasty like
the
that.
Light rays here.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
Just makes for a beautiful afternoon thing in this plastic, this cardboard room.
Mm-hmm. Everyone seems to notice the veggie anatomy chart on the wall behind Junior, behind Lenny.
Yeah, it's Lenny. Remember what he was named at first before he was named Lenny?
What was it?
Lester.
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 Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Lester.
I remember that.
That's a great little bit there, people.
Yep.
Listen carefully to what Percy P.
Yeah, Percy's
says
talking about
off.
being diabetic and needing to eat every few hours.
That was Phil ad-lib and so funny.
Hard to catch.
There's some great ad-lib in this show.
There is.
Uh-oh. It's a ruse, Brian.
It is.
Is it real?
Yeah, poor Lenny in this segment. The way, you know, there's not a lot of action in this 10-minute segment, but there's this kind of repeated, I called it dominoes. Like, Lenny keeps getting excited about something and then gets crushed when it turns out to be not what he thought it was going to be. So every scene in this show has a setup and then a fall when Lenny realizes things aren't what he thought.
Like that one right there. Oh,
right.
How many
that's
of you
really
have your sisters
dress.
Call you weird? Brian, your sister call you weird?
No.
My sister never called me weird.
You don't have a sister.
That's right.
Here's mom staring at the wall.
That's a really nice Art Deco window there on the sink. That's really cool.
It's interesting. There ended up being a little more of a Victorian vibe because of some of the reference I'd sent to the artists about what this might look like. Had this Victorian thing going. And
oh, yeah.
So it ended up being this kind of strange blend of Victorian and Art Deco.
Yeah, yeah.
But it works.
Yeah.
And it's a definitely beautiful segment. Here we've got Mom being voiced by Carrie Passapia, who first did it in 'Twas the Night Before Easter. She's another one of our regulars with Megan. Whenever we need a female voice, we go to Carrie and Megan and say, hey, what can you do?
But Lisa Vischer is the singing voice.
Yeah. Lisa Vischer does do the singing voice here. That's right.
Famously.
This is a beautiful little song.
Great job, Mike.
Mike, I think we already said this, but you wrote this whole segment all by your little self and wrote this song that... just, I think, beautifully sums up a message of hope and joy for this little boy who's feeling so down.
Well, and I think it's great. This short for me, I know, I'm sure you guys have had the same thing where one of your kids comes in just so upset and mm-hmm. you miss the mark. Like mm-hmm. you kind of go, oh, they're probably upset about whatever.
Yeah.
And then you find out it's about something that's rather touching or heartbreaking.
Yeah,
and you
absolutely.
Just, so in the turn that happens in a minute here, you know, she's doing a good job. I've done this. I've been the comforting parent. And then it turns and you go, oh, no, I missed it. I'm so
sorry. It's actually this whole other thing.
Yeah. And their tears were justified and real.
Yeah. It breaks your heart as a parent.
Yeah. Which go ahead.
Oh, and I was just going to say, I mean, that's what we were really trying to do is sort of mirror that relationship between parent and child and then God and his children, you know, just to say mom loves Junior so much and wants to comfort him in the same way that God wants to comfort us, and ultimately, you know, we know that there he promises in the end things will be better regardless of what our situation is now.
Right.
We can have the hope of you know, of no more pain and no more sorrow.
I love this twist coming up here with the leap year thing. Because, you know, there's this great pantheon of missed birthday stories, you know, in the world, and especially in, like, sitcoms. You know, it's like the standard episode where somebody thinks that his friends are going to throw a party for him and nobody mentions his birthday, and at the end they throw him a big party. And you kind of think that's how this one is going to go.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it's, oh, wait, it's actually not even your birthday. And so that's such a fantastic twist to add to that litany of missed birthday stories.
And Mike, did you have, because we talked about this, that this will release in a leap year, actually fairly close to, you know, when this is occurring. Did you have that in mind when you wrote it?
I don't think I even did. I think that was just a happy coincidence. Yeah, because as I was working out the mechanics of how would he lose his birthday, you know, it just occurred to me. And we had a family friend whose birthday was February 29th. And so that's the first place I went. Oh, that's an odd birthday. What if it were February? And as I did the math in my head, it's like, no, that wouldn't work. Oh, but what if it is March 1st? You know, so that's sort of my line of thinking on it.
Uh-huh. Now, unfortunately, if you look at that calendar closely, it doesn't work.
Well, Junior wrote the calendar.
Well, no, it's that it actually starts on a Monday.
Yeah.
But you have to assume that the calendar goes Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Yeah. Like, but the first block is a Monday.
Yeah. It's the boys, the BITs.
The boys in the
boys
sink.
Boys in the sink.
Woo-hoo.
Well, we did
it was fun to drag them out again.
It was. You know, we did a contest for if I sang a silly song was what we titled again, a Facebook thing. And we had a number of fans write in, you know, and give their ideas. If I sang a silly song, it would be about blank. And I went through a lot of, there's probably, you know, 400 or 500 submissions that I went through. And, you know, there was a lot of great ideas, but, you know, just that single word bubble wrap really, you know, stood out to me.
Bubble wrap.
And so, and that's what made me want to pull out the boys in the sink and make it, you know, kind of a rap thing. So,
but they needed a bit of a refresh because their costumes were about 10 years old.
Yeah, originally, you know, originally the boys in the sink. Yeah, originally when the Boys in the Sink came out, it was about a couple years after the decline of, you know, the first round of boy bands.
Right.
So even at the time, I remember thinking, okay, you know, boy bands have been kind of done, but the characters in themselves are just so fun. But, you know, the whole thing of boy bands has just been so enduring, you know, like, you know, there's so many boy
bands still
around. In fact,
by the time this video comes out, there'll be boy bands again.
And there'll be boy bands again. Well, actually, yeah, you can turn on TV and find, like, a million boy band shows.
Yeah.
So,
so we redesigned new costumes for them, kind of based on more of a hip-hop style. And produce the song more of a hip-hop song and less of a boy band song.
Yeah.
I think it's a great refresh.
Lots of auto-tuning, which is hysterical.
Oh, yeah. We're listening to a pre-produced version, so we're not hearing the auto-tuning yet, but I'm sure it'll be...
I'm sure you people at home are really enjoying all that.
Yeah.
And it's fun to bring Khalil back out. He's actually, the costume he's wearing was his costume from Jonah from the very end when he showed up as the truck driver. But I replaced tow truck driver logos. Actually, the one on his jacket says Eustace because of Eustace Scrub from Tolkien.
Yeah.
Tolkien, C.S. Lewis.
C.S. Lewis.
Forgive me.
They were buddies.
My nerd card.
And the dishes crash.
Ah! Mm-hmm. That's the big ending. Snap. Remember how hard it was for us to figure out that big ending? Mm-hmm. Like, we could not figure out the last joke until, like, the last day of production, mm-hmm. or of pre-production. Mm-hmm. It was like, well, what if they break all these dishes that they've been protecting the whole song? Mm-hmm. And, boy, is that funny.
Robin Good.
Here we go. Robin Good and his Not So Merry Men.
Not So Merry Men.
Well, this one, you know, had a fun genesis to it, you know, and the topic of where's God when I'm hurting, you know, we went through a lot of different ideas and versions of the story. At one point, we were trying to marry David and Jonathan to Robin Hood, and it turned out that trying to put both those stories together was a tough marriage, and so we decided to save David and Jonathan for another episode and just, you know, go the Robin Hood method. And then we wanted to get just a hook. What would be a clever hook behind doing VeggieTales version of Robin Hood, and that turned into...
Well, more than just needing a clever hook, like, we couldn't have a story where people were robbing. You know, robbing
from the rich. And exactly.
Like,
and so
that's
then
that's not veggie, to have good characters,
yeah,
you know, who are looked on well, yeah, to be robbing from anyone.
And you know, and that turned to be the thing is, you know, fundraising from the rich and giving to the poor, you know, felt like a clever way to treat that.
I remember that meeting where we were hashing that out, and I think you were the first one to say it, Mike, and it was like, oh, that's good.
This is Little John. So, and we're always, you know, having a son in Boy Scouts and, you know, daughter involved with, you know, school things. It's like, you know, the fundraising thing is always happening and, you know, trying to sell popcorn and, you know,
I just had to turn down, Chris's son yesterday for popcorn.
Yeah, it's like you have to, the poor boy is having to flip all these hats. Like, he's got to do, sell this card for this thing for that, popcorn for this.
Yeah, yeah. We just wrote the $75 check for popcorn this year.
Said, so we're done.
We're done. Here's
$75. And you got one pack of microwave.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
These voices here, this is actually Scooter and Misak Mitha in a different form. Misak Mitha, you'll remember, was from Esther originally, voiced by Shar Jackson. And we had tried some other voices here originally that just didn't quite work. I'm sorry, Chris. And and we just
I got
wanted,
shot down, people. But don't worry, I've got it coming back at because Brian crashed and burned.
Even though they're not important characters, we wanted to, because they started the show, they really needed.
I like the Abraham Lincoln shillings, by the way. I just noticed the Abraham Lincoln shillings.
Yeah, that's a nice touch.
Ending our history here.
Yeah. Well,
boys, one is better than none. We actually at one point talked about having the currency of the world be ham. Like instead of giving coins, mm-hmm. they would actually like slice a piece of ham off of a you know, leg.
Which I think is when I threw down the that's too ridiculous.
Yeah.
I often go too far in the ridiculous department.
It could have been cool. The thing that you never know though is if you do something like that, are people going to get it? You know,
yeah.
And so you worry. Okay, is it going to take too much time to know if that's going to work or not?
Okay, and these guys are actually from
Australia.
They're friends of ours. We needed some kids with good accents.
So the Australians will recognize those as Australian accents, not British.
British, but all of us US people are like, man, that sounds pretty good.
Well, I mean, we decided that a legit Australian accent was better than a put-on English accent.
It was, yeah.
And I've got little nephews in England, you know, but it's like, for that little part, it wasn't worth flying them over.
We worked a lot here to get... Purloin. Love that. Really worked on the accent here because Cockney becomes really hard to understand.
Yes.
And this was an interesting balance between getting kind of
that. Well,
cool,
and especially
authentic...
for Mrs. Lewis, who's also known as Mrs. Clark, who was the teacher in the Lenny segment. I don't think we've ever done that before, where we had the same character with a completely different voice in two different parts of one show. But I hope it works.
Well, yeah, she's obviously, you know, dressed differently. Hopefully,
yeah, exactly.
Just looking at that scene, I really want to celebrate my next birthday with the birthday ham.
I like the birthday rule myself.
Yeah,
poor kids.
These woods, by the way, are beautiful, particularly at night.
Mm-hmm. That looks like
the fire is so.
Looks like a miniature version of the tree in what's the Wild Kingdom. What's the place in Disney?
Oh, Animal Kingdom.
The Animal Kingdom, yeah.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with that tree. It actually was, it's based on, there's this Robin Hood kind of oak tree in England, this real tree that's part of the Robin Hood mythology there. And so it's based on that tree. In the original versions of the story, they were supposed to hide in the tree, and it served a much bigger role. But now it's just kind of where they light their campfire.
Was that kind of like the Lost Boys in Peter Pan? Same kind of a thing? Didn't the Lost Boys hide in a tree in Peter Pan?
I think so.
He probably got that from Robin Hood, because it predated the...
That's true.
So this is the point where they decide to actually rob, but it's clear that they're making a poor choice.
Mm-hmm. So, a footnote here, Dustin, who's our production coordinator, and myself are big fans of the Robin Hood lore, have seen all the films done on it, read a lot of books on the subject, so it was very tough for us going into the story and not wanting to just really do an authentic Robin Hood story.
With a real Will Scarlet and a real Little John.
So we had to kind of let that go and enjoy the adaptation here, you know, the veggieization, if you will, something like.
Lunt makes a dashing
but
Will Scarlet.
Does a really good job.
But he is not, as a character, he is not Will Scarlet.
But he does a nice job of kind of leading the group away. Oh, Robin.
Sad little moment for Robin here.
Yeah. We had a longer scene edited of this where the guys really got confused. They got all lathered up about the excitement of, we're going to go to something different. And they started to go away and realized, wait, we're leaving Robin. Why isn't he coming? And it was really charming. Ultimately, it was too long and we had to cut it back. But, the guys are still very funny.
Why are there giants in this story, Mike?
Why are there giants in this story?
Because that's not what you think of in Robin Hood, necessarily.
Yeah. I'm trying to remember. It's been a while. But, I know. Wait, let me think. Okay, we had it started with when it was David and Jonathan. Yeah,
right.
Because David and the giant pickle. And then we brought in the giant, the Goliath element. Yeah, so we did all of that. And then, yeah, so there was things that carried over, you know, from that original version of the story.
Yeah, we had this great giant designed, and we were like, well, we might as well use him as a...
He's a really fun, by the way, design for us. Just he's scary, but he's also, you know, infant-like. You know,
Mark Camelbeck. That's the Mark's last name. I just remember.
Wow.
He designed this giant. A fan actually has already asked why we didn't choose to use Goliath again, because since we already had a giant,
sure.
And that was actually a conscious choice because this giant needed to be more of a monosyllabic kind of grunty giant. And I didn't feel like bringing Goliath back for that kind of part was, you know, Goliath is an intelligent giant, and I needed more of a kind of dumb, cute giant. So we went with made a new guy.
That was what the casting call actually went out as.
Who was the voice of the dumb, cute giant?
That was Dustin Ballard.
Dustin Ballard has no reflection on his personal intelligence. The sparse town at night, Miss Lewis, who's everywhere with this wood. This pays off in the end of the film.
Sort of.
We were like,
very
okay,
loosely.
What business can she be doing? Because she really does show up in a lot of places. What can she be about? Well, what if she's gathering wood? The middle of
town. And
then
what does she do with the wood?
The middle of town in the dirt seems like an obvious place where wood would be left behind. I don't know why there are these trees in the town. So we do get to pay off by the end of it. But
we get this sweet little moment.
Now, Mike, this is you as well, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. We did this little lullaby.
So sweet.
I love the music box.
Okay, I'm just gonna don't fall asleep, guys.
It's supposed to be to fall asleep. Oh, look at Larry.
He's
getting
already getting
so sleepy.
Just there he goes. He's coming down. Brian, wake up.
I'm awake. In retrospect,
Larry's
him falling asleep.
Larry's
is
looking a lot like that Viva from Vendetta guy, you know.
Guy Fawkes?
Yeah. When he gets tired, especially, his eyes get all droopy. See, he's at the sit-in on Wall Street.
It's a little strange that we have. It's a little strange that we've got
Occupy Bethlehem.
We've got the hero falling asleep in the middle of the song that's teaching him, you know, how he should live.
Yeah, great way to pay attention, buddy.
It's a bit of an oddity, but I think it works.
Oh, the town is a bustle.
The crowds,
and bustling stuff there.
We had some small crowds in the last couple episodes of VeggieTales, but in this show we really needed a kingdom full.
You needed a town in your town.
We needed a kingdom full of people. And personally, I'd never really been satisfied with the, you know, painted people on cards that don't really move solution that we've used in a few other shows.
Oh, come on.
To which I argue, if George Lucas can use Q-tips, you can use cards.
You can, but it has to be in the right kind of shot, and we really needed crowds that held up. So I challenged the great technical minds at Hoo Hoo, our animation partner, to give me like actual crowds of like 50 people. And they did a fantastic job following through on that.
We had a bunch of ad-lib with Phil here on that microphone. That was really funny. That ultimately didn't make the edit, unfortunately. Didn't quite know.
On the microphone?
On the microphone.
It was actually Mike.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's me.
Oh, that was you.
Yeah, that's Jerry. Yeah, that's Jerry Gord.
Jerry Gord. Yeah.
Jerry rhymes with Larry.
Yeah. You are certainly grateful that that's Phil right there.
That's right. Mm-hmm. He did a great job.
Oh, yeah.
This is an interesting role for Bob. I really don't know of... I can't think off the top of my head of another episode where Bob was basically a bad guy.
Yeah, this is really more of a character that Lunt fits into, where he's the sidekick.
Well, although Bob is, you know, he's a reluctant bad guy.
He is, absolutely.
Yeah, he's sort of trapped by the prince into a job he doesn't want to do.
And we were a little worried about that. We had versions where, like, oh, Bob has a sick son that he has to take care of, so that's why he has to
work for the prince. What's his motivation? Right. Yeah, but we didn't need to go that far with it.
In the end, we just felt like, oh, he just needs the job. And so he does things that he'd rather not.
Great action. Oh, look at this hero. That's
I'm not sure why the kids didn't just run away. But...
Deer in the headlights syndrome.
They panic. Yeah.
Panic keys.
And now, there he goes. Why'd you
let that happen? Here we introduce the idea of the Dungeon of Despair. Dungeon with you.
Now, initially, in one of the drafts, we had the boot, and he would give these people
the boot,
and he'd boot them out of town, and it was very entertaining.
Yeah.
And that came back in Action Climax, but then we introduced the dungeon.
It got weird because he would boot people and then want to get rid of them.
And then throw the boot away.
Yeah. It
didn't quite work.
It's like, give him the boot and then get rid of him. Well, but giving him the boot does get rid of him.
Just these things that
did you note the sheriff's hair earlier?
I have not. That was a total accident.
The hair on the sheriff, this is just, by height, the best hair Bob's ever had.
Oh, yeah. Far.
It's very, he used the, what's the shampoo that gives you more volume? The volumizing shampoo?
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Is that little like gray streaks in there?
Yes, it's gray streaks.
Yeah.
When we made the shift away from the David and Jonathan story, it became much more important that Bob visually be aligned with Prince John. And Prince John had this great hair, and so Todd Carter, our storyboard artist, needed to start boarding, but we didn't have concept yet. And so his first few boards came back with Bob with this like TV evangelist, you know, Inigo Montoya hair. Or not Inigo, it's actually the five-fingered man. And it just was like, oh, that's the silliest thing I've ever seen. Can we do that?
And they did.
Well, now the little flare on the side definitely takes it more Renaissance, you know. It doesn't go evangelist.
Okay, and here comes a great little I believe you. Good name. Great. No, versal cleverness from Tim Hodge.
Oh, yeah.
Tim did a
who's on first.
Tim did a comedy pass on our script, which is where you kind of take a script to a writer and say, hey, can you add some jokes? And Tim's great at jokes.
Chef Mediocre, that's the funniest. It's good. Robin Good. Oh,
here it is. That's good stuff. Nice to meet you, Robin. For the longest time, we were just calling him Robin Hood. And towards the end, of development of writing the script, we said, well, what if it's something else? What if it's Robin Good? And that kind of stuck and gave us that great
title. Which is really his behavior is such that it's a fun little turn on the thievery.
Yeah.
Notice Jimmy Gord eating the stick there.
It's a great little bit.
He didn't have any food, so he just had to eat the stick. Well, what
do you suggest? These guys are so smart.
Are we supposed to say something about the Oompa Loompas right now? I'm not sure. No. Okay.
What about the Oompa Loompas?
Oh, the Oompa Loompas. Oh, yeah. Bob's hair is an Oompa Loompa hair. That's what it is. Brilliant.
Jeremy. That is funny.
All right. This
here we have the most awkward scene in VeggieTales history.
This scene was actually edited by my friend Mark Kiefer. Is this table made out of hobby? And
it had a lot more dialogue in the script.
Nice. And he delivers it just this dead, empty room. And we just laughed so hard. And thought it so Just the chewing sounds. Is that basil
I smell? We worked hard on those chewing sounds. I love basil. Like I remember he put that basil line in because you were growing basil in your garden that summer.
That's right, yeah. I had two kinds of basil in my garden. I had the regular basil and then Thai basil. And I noticed that Thai basil, I'm able to help survive a lot better than regular basil. I don't know what that, you know, but we still have Thai basil. You could just rip it right off and throw it on a burger and it's delicious.
So Brian had this idea here that in his pitch, what if he did like a PowerPoint presentation.
Right, a medieval PowerPoint presentation. What would that look like?
Brian kind of threw this together.
So he has this button that he pushes, and a pea pulls a cord that makes a slide fall on the sheet. It's pretty silly. Here you can see that charitable giving is again, way down this year, leaving few options for those. Chris is usually my silliness gauge of when I've gone too far.
Did you do the chart yourself there too?
No, one of Hoo-Hoo's guys did that.
All right, here comes this magnificent song.
This is a Mark Steele song.
This is one of my really fun songs. When he first pitched this, I came into Brian's office and said, "This is fantastic. This is a great classic Nezzer." And Brian liked it, but it took a little time to kind of.
It did. I had to warm up to it. Do the math. It's really important to us that we have singable songs that kids can follow along with. And this song is not so easy to follow along with.
Well, it's a challenge, which can be a lot of fun. I know that's true. A lot of songs you kind of want to you want to get them down, and so you practice them and practice them.
We had to. We ran out of time with Phil when we were supposed to record it. We had about 30 minutes left in the session. And we said, why don't you just start the song and see how it goes? And he listens to the song once through, and he's like, I'm not going to do that in 30 minutes.
And he didn't.
I'm going to have to come back. And he wasn't. He had a really hard time with the song, even with some practice. But by the end of it, he's like, okay, I really like it.
Yeah, it is, once you learn your part, it's really fun to sing.
Okay, I want to note that's real juggling happening there. It drives me nuts in animation when, and this is the total animator cheat, they just make the juggled things go in a circle.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
And it's like, that's not how you juggle. So I made sure they gave that shot to an animator who could actually make it look like he's really juggling.
And there was your cat screech.
There's a couple of the show.
So the guys are slipping in here. This was an amazing bit of boarding to try to figure out how to get these two guys singing the song, dancing around the hallway whilst the guys come in.
Most believably not noticing
that these guys are stealing on the sandwich.
Right.
And this is like a bit of stretching of the set and a throwing of the pee.
Not yet.
Oh, yeah. There it is. that joke never gets old. That was actually, this is kind of a funny little bookend, but the first show that I worked on when I joined you guys back in 2004 was Menace of the Cuke, and in that Robin Good story, that Robin Hood story.
With Junior,
we threw a peek. It was Tim's gag.
He'd
throw him in the pile.
Yeah.
So to bookend it here with another Robin Hood story.
Yeah.
Do it again.
Yep.
Perfect.
That's cool. I never realized that. What? Oh, and then the set there is actually from King George and the Ducky.
No, so, it's not.
Well, I mean, I think it was kind of based off of it, right?
Not even close.
Really?
It looks just like it.
It looks nothing like it.
It looks like it to me.
It's completely different.
It feels like it.
Yeah, it does not feel like it.
Okay. I think in the world of medieval king's thrones.
This is so much prettier than that set.
Oh, those cuffs are used for what?
Exactly, that's Bob's problem. Yeah. He pulls the cuffs out and doesn't know what to do with them, which gives Robin the chance to escape.
Mm. Great little action. This was I remember your description of handoff was, "Hey, board artists, give me some Errol Flynn like sequence here of just him bounding around the room." Now, where does he jump to exactly?
To his death.
Yeah, we needed an Errol Flynn banner hanging from the wall so that he could swoop away.
And then he jumps off and got down the banner and slides down. And, but we trimmed that and just some location trimming.
It's easier to just go away when you jump off a balcony.
It works.
All right, so here's the actual thieves. This was an added little bit that we did fairly late because we wanted to have some pitter-patter after he left to get us to do something else before we meet Robin Woods.
Right.
And it's just like...
I don't know where they were going. They were actually headed back to the castle.
Back.
It just feels like they're heading away. My
friends, my fundraising.
Usually when you go from right to left, you're headed away.
I can't even go back to Bethlehem.
All right, speaking of outtakes here, this was actually the cue of a big, long version of the song from Larry.
Wow, you're everywhere.
That we, after kind of getting to the finish line, realized it wasn't needed in the
song.
Yeah, we were just kind of at a place where we felt like we knew the lesson. And I think, Mike, that was your suggestion, actually.
It was.
Yeah, because...
we sang the song four times.
Yeah, sang it four times. The third time, which is like the kind of the heart of the song, when, you know, later when Robin Good is consoling the sheriff.
Not to spoil the story.
Yeah, not to say... Well, you've probably seen it since you watched.
Yeah,
but we then had, at that point, it was just the third time that we heard it, so it just started to feel really preachy. And so... You know, my thought was, well, let's just cut the middle time that we sing it, cut it in this scene, and that'll have more meaning when we see it later.
And we sweated it so long in development, Brian and I were talking about this earlier, that this scene, because we wanted to make sure that that Larry felt alone and kind of hit his low, it didn't matter. Like, with that song, that wasn't the necessary. Like, just seeing him in the woods alone was enough.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, this plays really well. John Waba did a great job of trimming this up for us.
Right. Love that Robin pulls back out the plastic hippo line.
Being alone from throwaway.
You thought you were at the end of your rope until you found someone else at the end of his.
I have to say that line.
I love Brian.
I still am not sure about that. She said, Miss Lewis says, you thought you were at the end of your rope until you found someone else at the end of his. And it always smacks me a bit of like, well, you think your life's bad, but this person over here has it worse, which is, you know, not a place we should take any comfort in.
Encouraging line.
It could always be worse.
Right, the runoff gag there of him running into the rock. I love punctuating scene with comedy. Brian's a good job there.
Thank you.
Here comes Brian Roberts.
Yes.
That's his little deciduous trees. So funny.
We just needed a bit of nonsense for the guards to say in the background.
That's exactly what they would be talking about. I love Tudor-style houses with the warm lights on.
I know. It's like a little Christmas village.
Yeah.
Oh, look.
One of my favorite visual gags ever. That we see the guys from behind first.
Todd boarded this.
Yeah.
The stocks.
Chris and I,
we have a firm debate on this. The stocks were my suggestion.
That's absolutely
untrue. We needed the guys to get captured but still be visible.
You know, the folks at home.
We haven't used stocks before. How about we use stocks? To which Brian then drew up the stocks, what that might look like. And it was very funny. It was basically this image.
Yeah.
And we all laughed. Ha ha ha. Then Brian has gone on to claim credit. Unjustly.
In the end, it doesn't matter.
Oh, right, sure.
What matters is that we all work together.
Todd's reveal of this show. I just thought it was the P and the...
Well, remember, if you guys remember the original version of the script, they were actually in the dungeon, but not the dungeon of despair.
But it was really posh.
But it was very posh, so the dungeon itself was, you know, one of them was in a
hot tub.
Like a hot tub,
yeah.
So, but
they had like a masseuse, I think.
Yeah, what was it? I forget what it was.
Like there was a hot tub and a masseuse and like a midnight buffet or something.
Yeah, yeah.
So the reason they're out here is they're supposed to be right next to their big thing. They're captured hams or stolen hams out there, and they're being punished for their crimes.
Well, they're being made a public mockery of them. They're being put on display as a warning to who else might think of stealing the prince's ham.
Yes.
Ham.
This is a little nod.
See, that set is so much prettier than the one from King George. You guys just don't know.
Okay, there's a great little aside there that Mike threw in as an ad lib.
You're the king.
You're the king. What about the mommy line?
I love what we do now. We didn't used to do as much of this, but we do a lot of ADR, which is dialogue replacement now, where you know, we'll go back and the animators will go through and they'll, you know, animate, you know, different mouth movements, you know, that we originally didn't record to, but then we'll get the chance afterwards to track those and put our voice to it. It adds a lot of depth to the scenes.
Okay. The harmonica is a bit of a leftover. There was this whole other scene where we saw the sheriff earlier in the dungeon that we cut where he'd been playing the harmonica.
Mm-hmm.
So we never actually see the sheriff playing the harmonica. No. It's just kind of there.
Well, I remember when we were recording with Phil with this, he was like, another harmonica in a dungeon scene?
How many times have we pulled this
out? We've done that a couple times, so it's probably best that
The rope and the dungeon key. This is a mic joke that is... That was
easy. Oh, about the key being thrown away.
Let's go. So good. And the linen rope, just handily.
Yeah. Happens to be there.
All tied off.
Well, because the guards need to go down into the dungeon of despair as well.
Tied off linen rope.
Got to clean up down there sometimes.
Oh, there's here's our hero. Heart that's too big for God. I know that your heart is hurting. Okay, so this one, the first time I heard this was actually in the mix, and I was kind of surprised. I thought we were missing something, and Brian says, no, this was actually my take, was to go more of a acapella, essentially, version of this tune, and it ends up being really quite special when you pull it out, particularly because it's really the only time we get to hear Larry sing it.
Mm-hmm.
He loves you when he's and who's playing the...
It's one of Kurt's sons. I think it's Clay.
Oh, it's Clay. Yeah, Clay has been taking violin lessons for years, and Kurt felt he was ready for his solo, ready for his close-up. He did a great job.
Yeah, it's lovely.
Yeah, he also did the little violin parts in the countertop when Larry is going on about Squeaky.
Yeah.
Which is so funny. That was a late addition.
Which Squeaky, we've had two hamsters in our family. Squeaky 1 and Squeaky 2. Because Squeaky 1 escaped.
Never to be found, or like,
well,
Lisa was vacuuming under the sofa
in
a few weeks later.
An olfactory sense, he was found. So we actually smelled something a little, you know, ripe after a while. So he probably got into the ventilation and
some great.
It's a hard knock life for him.
It's a shame you didn't have this video to watch then.
Yeah, exactly. So then we got Squeaky 2, and then when we moved, we, you know, donated him to somebody.
This is some really great cloth work, by the way.
Donated him to the backyard.
His blanket is very snuggable.
Notice the ham. Notice the ham holders. On the throne.
Ham holders, that's right.
Yes, he's got ham holders on
is
the throne.
Is that like a reclining?
Like, well, like on a fishing chair, you know, you have the fishing rod
exactly.
holders in it.
Yeah, he's got ham holders.
Yeah. And the sheep.
Baba. That was actually Leslie's idea.
It was really goofy.
I couldn't believe she would let me do that.
Teddy.
This bit was really tough. We edited around quite a bit trying to get the tension on
Larry
the
and the sheriff
what
on
do we
the
do
rope?
Here? Yeah.
Yes.
And then
I think we should have edited a bit more.
Well, the payoff of them landing and it being a foot away is always a good.
Maybe Teddy should sample the salad bar on occasion.
Down they go.
Wow.
Aha. Uh-huh. Okay, they went far at all.
I love that Teddy is a squeaky toy. It's like he's a dog bear. Like a toy for dogs.
All right, so these guys are geniuses. They have a great plan for.
Okay, let's talk about motivation for the giant.
Well.
So he comes into the kingdom now because
he smelled the ham, which is on display in the cart.
That we mentioned earlier.
And that has drawn him into, that is why tonight of all nights he has chosen to break down the door.
Tonight of all nights.
Great.
Why?
We didn't really establish that, Mike, I realize. Pointed out so nicely. But here he is. He's a giant. Yeah. He's cute and toothy.
Just a little ham waft. That's all I want.
That's all I wanted.
Just a little ham waft.
Do you know how expensive those are?
Sorry, Mike. It was out of
wafts
budget.
Are not free.
This chase sequence, though, this is another one we worked on to try to make, you know, intense but not too scary.
Yeah. And what's interesting is we kind of shoot the village as if it goes on forever. But everything just happens within about 10 feet of each other.
It does.
And like I know that. I'm not sure for the audience whether it feels like the village is actually bigger than it is or they get there.
Oh, it does to me. Yeah, it does.
Okay, so lots of hams flying here.
There was a funny animation note here, because I kept telling the animators, like, they would send me the shot and there'd be like one ham and I'd be like, more ham. And then the next time I come back I'd be like, still not enough ham. I said more ham.
Like you're at the deli.
And the third time I'm like, okay, for the third time, I need more hams in this shot. And the animation supervisor, Bill Boyce, was like, oh, I'm so sorry, I forgot to tell you. That's going to be done later.
In effect.
That's an effect.
This shot here with the giant leaning in and what he was going to do, we talked about, wrestled with, edited 100 different ways.
Well, originally, he saw one of the targets, and it looked like his mother, and it turned out that he was just looking for his mother all along. And then we decided that was kind of weird, so we decided he wanted the ham, but I made the point that, well, if he's going to eat all their ham, then they're no better off than they were under Prince John. which is why he just eats one ham and then goes away.
Yeah, but yeah. So, or he could have been a giant who loved ham but also loved to share. So he just wanted one ham. So he would have had his one ham and then shared his ham
with
the others.
Mike and I ganged up on Brian.
Well, but
to change it from the
from the mom thing
to the ham. So actually, if you listen, when the giant's screaming, he's actually saying mom.
There's our note. Sorry. Miss Lewis brings the wood to the fire.
Oh, there's
the
payoff on
there. All the wood she's been collecting.
It'd be kind of funny if they
burned. And the sheriff, who's been taking ham the whole show, is now giving it away.
Oh,
and gives some to Miss Lewis. It's so sweet.
All
well, there you go.
There you have it. And look at that. Squeaky came home.
Unlike off screen.
unlike real life when Squeaky... Well, Squeaky never really left home.
Squeaky went home to his... Squeaky went to his heavenly home.
That's right.
We didn't mention this in the front end, but his costuming, his little bandage with his little Band-Aid on top.
Oh, that's super cute.
So cute.
Yeah. It's like I learned in Lenny and the Lost Bird. It's almost like... I remember Flipper Aloo where he was all bandaged up, where he got all... And I think that was mostly head-based.
Yeah.
Well, Meaningful Life, he had a similar thing, but it actually went all the way up over his mouth.
Yeah. In times like that, it's funny to try to get a cucumber in traction.
So this, we didn't talk about this either, but the boy that his letter, we actually shot here at Big Idea in our conference room.
Right,
we
tried to make it look like he just moved.
Yeah, so we put boxes and a little sheet in there. And
wrapped up the sofa in plastic.
That sheet in the back is hanging on our very nice flat screen TV on the wall, which did not break.
That's good.
Those boxes are empty, obviously.
We got to figure out what to do about Bob's reaction to this song, because it's become kind of weird.
It's an old gag now.
Yeah. Well, you know, we have an upcoming show where he really likes it.
That's true.
So, you know, and there's a little surprise there, but we'll, pretty soon he'll just...
This was also wrestled. This verse, I think we had, five or six at one point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of, you know...
Just trying to get the right idea.
Well, I think when we zeroed in on there is no hurt too big for God.
Which Leslie was kind of the anchor on that.
She was. She helped us zero in on that. I think that's when the verse really crystallized as that one.
Right.
I love
which
Larry.
And it's a beautiful verse, and it's so true. And just that concept that there's no hurt too big for God.
Never mind.
What I love about it is like I said at the beginning, we wanted something that applied to someone who lost their hamster or someone who's, you know, lost their grandmother or worse.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, and I love when Larry says, well, how do I do that? How do I give my burdens to God? And he's talking to Mrs. Lewis. You know, and she says, tell him your heart is hurting. Tell him you're feeling blue. You know, tell him you can't do it yourself. And I really feel strongly that we accomplished what we set out to at the beginning, which was to give a show that gives a concrete biblical lesson to children about what they can do when they're hurting and about what is true about God when they're hurting.
Right.
And
rather than
really
just
happy
to say,
about that.
You know, oh, don't worry, everything's going to be okay. You know,
exactly.
There's a future and a rock that's unmoving in God,
mm-hmm.
which in an ever-moving society is a great message to have out. Well, great show, everybody. Nicely done, all.
Yeah.
Editorial was crazy. You'll notice there are three names, four total. It was a lot of work.
Yeah, including John, because John edited the Lenny segment.
We didn't really talk about the kind of pace of the schedule, but this one, because of kind of figuring out the story, this is probably one of the fastest shows I've ever produced, from script to
script. I think it is. The only one
that's
really, the only one close is Wizard of Oz. And,
and it was in the middle, for me personally, of a lot of hurt. As you recall, I was out for a family funeral in the middle of this.
Oh, yeah.
So a lot of personal things going on at the same time as this big story trying to get figured out.
And,
it's just remarkable. I will say that, you know, as tough as all that was, it is clear that we were telling the right story because I felt like really God's hand was on us to kind of keep moving along, you know?
Yeah.
There was plenty of times where we should have just been like a brick wall. We're done. We can't do this.
Exactly.
This is impossible.
And it actually, you know, in the end, it ended up coming in a little early. I think when animation finished, they, you know, got through all of this great story, and the team at Hoo-Hoo just did a phenomenal job.
Big thanks to all of them whose names just finished scrolling up.
Yes. Great support.
So, Mike, thanks for letting me direct another of your scripts.
Oh, thanks. And, my thanks to you guys as well. And, you know, great job on it. And, you know, Mark, who's not here right now, developing it with us.
Mm-hmm.
Also, it's a pleasure to work with him.
Yeah.
wrote what hopefully will be a legendary song that we all talk about for years.
Yeah.
The Him I Am song.
Him I Am.
Absolutely.
So. Well, cool. Thanks, guys.
All right. Nice signing off.
Yep, see there's Leslie's name. That means it's over.
Bye, everybody.
Bye, everybody. Thanks for everything.